Well, I've never tried a video quite like this before, but I'm a huge fan of the British pop duo Tears for Fears. They've been around since the 80s. You probably know them from their mega hits, Everybody Wants to Rule the World, Shout, all that kind of stuff. But they have made some astonishing records over the past decades, and they just came out with a brand new record, Songs from a Nervous Planet, which I have not heard yet, and I'm really excited to dive into and just kind of listen to as a piece of art. A lot of times, Tears for Fears often incorporate so many vast different influences in their work that I love taking it apart and kind of just kind of seeing what I notice. So I hope this is kind of interesting, just in the flow of the artistic spirit, to explore the influences, the ideas, what works, what doesn't. Hey, not everything they does is fantastic, but I will recommend to you their 2004 album, Not Everybody Wants to Rule the World. Everybody Loves a Happy Ending. It is a masterpiece from top to bottom. And if you enjoy this video, maybe I'll go take that one apart at some point in the future. But meanwhile, I'm here to listen to Songs from a Nervous Planet, and I'll just kind of freewheel and talk about the things that I notice while I listen. First thing I'm seeing as I'm just looking at the screenshot is it's actually only a four-track album. I see four songs, and then I see a whole bunch of live tracks, which they may be great. I recognize, I think, all the titles as far as I think probably all the titles come from previous releases, but now they're live. They're probably a lot of fun. I'm not going to focus on them for today's video. I'm just going to listen to the four new tracks. So I'm going to put on my trusty headphones here, my AKGs, and have a listen. Let's see what we notice. So I hope you enjoy this record. I'm just going to go ahead and talk over it with any thoughts I have as we go along. Here goes. So I always look for that, like, where do they go? They start on the one chord and then they go to a minor. So I'm looking like, how are they establishing the sound and the direction of this song? Got kind of a cheesy whistle lead there. One thing that Tears for Fears does exceptionally well is their layering. They do several concurrent layers of musical depth at the same time. I'm going to point that out. I'm sure it's going to happen as the record goes along. But right here, you got the melody, you got some pad stuff, but you've got that really nice low guitar, dun, 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 just playing that eighth note pulse. And you can hear a little melody in there. That's the kind of thing they do a lot of. These vocal textures are really beautiful, and they make this in-between section really fascinating. Drums pair back, and this is clearly leading somewhere. Ooh, major this time, it was minor last time. Tears for Fears have a wonderful way of combining light and dark at the same time. This is very bright up-tempo pop song, but you can also hear there's plenty of darkness in it. I'm not really listening to the lyrics right now. Same key lyric, let's see if they take it in a new direction. You know, as far as kind of criticism goes, this isn't strikingly original to me yet. Like, I don't feel like they're taking me to a new place like some of the best of Tears for Fears does. But there's little touches, like, you hear that a second ago? Kind of interesting. Really interesting kind of detuned guitar with some kind of crazy tremolo on it. I mean, this is great pop. I don't know that it's, so far, it's not as groundbreaking as I've heard some of their older stuff has been. And there's that whistle. Again, just going back to the layers concept, Tears for Fears will layer things on top of things and then superimpose them in ways that you may not expect, which is something they do really well. Makes music really interesting. You hear that high vocal now, just the ooze. And now we're back to the minor version of the chord changes. Kind of putting me to sleep here a little bit. Like, yeah, it's just standard pop, but they're not doing anything new with it, and that's making me go, this isn't the peak of originality as far as I have come to expect from Tears for Fears. Still, kind of a solid opener. Yeah, I enjoy it. I don't know that I'll go back and listen to it, you know, 100 more times. Track 2, The Girl That I Call Home. Okay, so already, they love playing with sounds, and this textury thing going on, it's being looped, and now bar 3 and bar 4, they add something new to it. So that motif, da-da-da-da, it's really simple. It's like four notes, but it's already giving you something simple that you can latch onto. And now I'll be listening to what can they do with that? What will they do with that as the song develops? There's a lot of things, subtle things here creating motion. You hear that hi-hat percussive stuff? And the steady pulse. How they're just creating forward motion in this song, even though this is a laid-back section. Big drums, very kind of reminiscent of Phil Collins. I wonder if this is my buddy Jamie playing on this. He's a great drummer. Cool hook, Girl That I Call Home. It's kind of a superimposition of a girl, a person, and home, and kind of superimposing that concept as a metaphor. Kind of cool. And it's simple. Girl That I Call Home. Five words, and they've communicated something very simple to you, but something they can hang a lot of other ideas on top of. Nice big drop, and sonically, this is gorgeous. It's nice and rich and full, and every layer is just calibrated. This makes me just enjoy this music unfolding. It's glorious. I love this. Oh, interesting. So some choral textures in here. Not sure why it's there, but it's interesting. And that kind of bass, dum, bum, 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 a little bit random. Where's it taking me? So that's hilarious. I made the Phil Collins reference earlier. That's like a total rip of the famous Phil Collins In the Air Tonight, Phil. But hey, it's great. You can borrow stuff like that. And it's a little homage to people who get the inside joke. Love it. One of the things I love about that 2004 album, Everybody Loves a Happy Ending, is it is such... It's the record that the Beatles would have made if they were still making music today. It's glorious. So many inside joke references there in such a subtle artistic way. It's an amazing album. Highly recommend. Anyway, this song here... very enjoyable. I don't know what it's about, because I'm not really listening to the lyrics, but I'm enjoying this sonic vista that they've created and they've orchestrated. Bring This Idea, which started the song back, is a really smart one, because it just puts a bow on the whole thing, and very cool. And that metallic clang makes me go, wow, interesting. Track 3, Emily Said. Those background vocals instantly make me feel like I'm listening to a modernized Beatles track. It's kind of an homage. Also, that descending bass line, Penny Lane, a little bit of trumpet in there. Oh. Interesting, unexpected modulation. Love it. Same walk down melody, Penny Lane, there is a barber showing photographs. You get the illusion? It's a little bit of that. Tears for Fears will do that. They're not ripping it off. They're just tipping the hat to it. Oh. You know, I love it when musicians do that. They just kind of take me to a new place that's unexpected. They're leading me. They're taking me someplace. And again, right there, new modulation. They're taking me someplace that they want to go, and they're inviting me along for the ride. It's very compelling. And now, modulate to the major. Did you hear two different sets of background vocals superimposed on each other? It's really cool. And that weird modulation, now that we've heard it at least twice now, it now feels like it's part of the DNA of the song. And I've come to expect it, but it's still cool. By the way, Penny Lane has unexpected modulations like that too. I have to take that apart in a separate video. Just remember, love is like not skin and bone. Just go easy on yourself, you're not alone. You could cry yourself to sleep and they won't know. You hear how those background vocals start with a different idea and then they merge with the lead? Right, coming together right there. Very cool. Also reminds me a little bit of one of my favorite singer-songwriters, Mike Viola. He'll write melodies and chord changes like that to keep you on your toes. If you haven't heard Mike, one of the best, the world's best singer-songwriters, listen to Hang On Mike, great album. I don't know what the saxophone trio is doing there. I applaud them for doing something different. It just kind of, that superimposed with the kids choir. Kind of like, I don't know what this is meant to be, but it's interesting. It's cool. It's unorthodox combinations. Things don't always have to be explained. And now, like, it's the payoff moment. So, hear that Penny Lane trumpet in there? There's a lot of allusions to Penny Lane in this song. See, this is very satisfying because, like, it all culminates here and all these ideas are now being drawn together. You hear those, I guess they're harp arpeggios. Fun. Very fun. Oh, I don't know why we're here. This reminds me of a McCartney outro. It was on Press to Play or Flowers in the Dirt, I can't remember. He just stuck this big band outro on it. I can't remember the song right now. I'll look it up later. You know what? It's just a weird outro stuck on there. Maybe this was an improv or an early version or something like that. That song, Emily Said, already one of my favorites. That one I would listen to again. So here's track 4, Astronaut. The best that I can. Wanna show everyone. So right now this is feeling very robotic, very, the rhyme is predictable, the road is just, you know, very kind of standard, the vocal is very tuned and very lined up. It's well sung and well played, I'm just kind of like, what is pulling me into this song yet? I haven't found it yet. Better do something. Interesting vocal samples. I didn't comment on the mellotron in the first verse. So that was a cool texture. Again, another kind of nod to the Beatles, who made that famous. Just a flame in the sky. I don't belong here. I got one eye on a different. There's something beautiful about this, because he's talking about like an astronaut, you know, eye in a different world, that kind of stuff. And we do kind of feel like we're floating in space a little bit. It's gravity, but it won't bring me down. gravity brings us down, the melody goes down, and the band gets more centered. What to make of this? I'm not falling in love with it because I'm like, what? Where is it going? Besides being a song about an astronaut, I'm not sure what he wants to do. Again, won't bring me down. Melody goes down. Okay, so now I'm feeling a little bit more of the payoff. Take a listen to that drum pattern. It's not a standard beat. It's kind of like a beat that restarts almost every measure. Very Ringo-like. Ringo would do left of center stuff like that that would make you go, why is he doing that? And then it would just become part of the DNA of the song, and you can't imagine the song without it. I feel like this song wants to be rock, but instead they've gone more synth pop. It's got a synth bass, it's got a lot of, there's an instrument there. It's not a theremin, but it's kind of reminiscent of a theremin, bit of a throwback thing. Tears for Fears writes very intelligent pop music. There's lots of little things like that that make you go, oh, that was just cool. And it was different. And it doesn't mean you have to love everything they do, but they have a way of coming up with a whole bunch of different ideas and then throwing them into the pot and making them fit in ways that you wouldn't necessarily expect. And I think that is a mark of a great orchestrator, you know, when we're talking about orchestral writing or film scores or trailers. But Tears for Fears do it in pop, which is one of the reasons I think they're a really special, special band. All right, I said I wasn't going to comment on these live tracks. This is not one of my favorites. Let me listen to a second of the Tipping Point. One thing about Tears for Fears, when they play live, they do not tend to deviate from their studio recordings much at all. So this is sounding just like the record. The Tipping Point was their last record from a few years ago. It is a good record. It's not my favorite, but it's a good one. I'm going to jump ahead in Tipping Point. Or no, maybe not. Because these are like those genius ideas that I love. This song is in 12/8, but they haven't really told you where the one is yet. And they always kind of keep you guessing until the beat comes in. It's coming in a minute. Oh, I think this might be a little different than the studio, the record version. Dum, bum, bum, bum. So they're giving you a piano idea and a vocal idea. You know that I can love you more. Idea one. Idea two. And you've got the groove. That's an idea of its own with lots of layers inside the band. I said I wasn't going to comment on this, but now I kind of don't want to stop it. All right, I'm going to do Tipping Point, then I'll quit for today. I love the... I mean, this is true of most songs in 12/8, but that constant velocity going forward, like it's so catchy. And there are syncopations, everything's off the beat. You can hear the drums accenting those moments too. There's the piano line. Vocals in harmony, it's subtle, it's standard, it's nothing special, but it really makes it stand out more than if it was just unison. You know that I can love you more. Okay, some synth accents in there. I don't remember that in the original. Maybe it is there. It's been a while since I've listened to this. Anyway, really cool record. It's going to be hard for me to talk and finish this up while that's playing, but I don't want to stop it either. Tears for Fears, man, that duo. I mean, they openly talk about how influenced they were by Lennon-McCartney. They are, in some ways, kind of a modern Lennon-McCartney. Their relationship is... I know it's been rocky at times. Did you hear that little... This extra repeats of stuff? The kind of... You think it's going in one direction, then it's taking you to another. And this very cool synth patch. It's just another idea they throw into the mix. Ba-da-da, ba-ba. And they just kind of, one of their superpowers is bringing everything full circle. Here we are, you know, most of the way through the song now, and you're like enjoying the chorus because now it's familiar to you and all those jigsaw pieces are fitting together. Okay, I'm going to take my headphones off. I'll let the music play because I can edit it later. But I really had fun with this, just kind of blind reacting to the new Tears for Fears record. Was it useful? If you enjoyed listening to my rambling over this record, let me know if I need to take apart other Tears for Fears records or other records indeed. I maintain a long list of videos that I'm like, one day when I have time to make, I would love to make. So I've got no shortage of ideas, but I also appreciate hearing from you in the comments or via the likes or the views, what has resonated with you. So, hey, I'm glad to have some new Tears for Fears on the shelf because they are just a fantastic band. So hope you enjoyed this. Like and subscribe if you did. You know, I always say that's the currency of today and that helps things keep moving. Lets me know what you like, lets YouTube know what other people should like, all that kind of stuff. So please do like and subscribe, I appreciate it, and I'll see you on the next one.